used to have an old Nazarene preacher in Britain. He was the most eccentric man that I think I ever met, and I've met some strange men. One of the worst things I had to do was sleep with him. And it's nice when people get blessed in the meeting and raise their hands, but he got blessed at 2 o'clock in the morning. And he walked around the bedroom in that old nightshirt he had, and he sang praises to God, and I tried to calm him down and tell him there were some people next door. He said, "Are they Christians?" "Yes." "Well, let them join us," he said. And I remember he got blessed on a streetcar once, and man, he brought the glory of God. I was embarrassed to death, honestly, goodness. I was hiding behind a newspaper and people reading newspapers out this way. And I was trying to calm him down, but he was a tremendous character, and he had a lot of little epigrams. And he used to say, "If you don't trust and obey, you'll rust and decay." So you better watch out. Let's read from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians, the third chapter. When Corinthians 3, and read from verse 9, "For we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry, ye are God's building. According to the grace of God which is given unto me." Yes, verse 10. "According to the grace of God which is given unto me, as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation. And another builder thereon, but let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. For other foundation can no man lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now if any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire. And the fire shall try every man's work." Notice what it says. Not what size it is, but what sort it is. Not quantity, but quality. "If any man's work abide which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss. But he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy." That's pretty severe. "For the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are." Last Lord's Day morning, we spent what time we had, which is never enough in my case, considering the judgment seat for sinners. We sing frivolously when all of life is over and our work on earth is done. Well, there's going to be a finale one day. The trumpet is going to sound. The Lord Jesus said, "Don't get excited because I raised Lazarus from the dead. The day is coming in the which," in John 5 and 28, "all who are in the grave shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they shall rise." Every one of them. Again, as you know, the Word of God says, "It is appointed unto man once to die, and after death the judgment." You can't send anybody in your place. You can't postpone your audience with God. You can't have an advocate there, a lawyer. It's going to be an awesome day, as I said, when he said, "I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God." With all that's going to come up in the next few days, with Mr. Nixon putting his version of the tapes out, there's one thing he never dreamed of, and that was that one day at the judgment seat of Christ, those tapes are going to be played. And we'll find out who did it, the dirty trick, whether he did it, or Miss Woods, or who in the world did it, but it's all going to come out. One of the greatest camouflages in history, in American history, was the, nearly said gentleman, I don't think that's the right name, Kennedy. Teddy Kennedy, when that tragedy of that girl that was lost, he died, it was covered up. He wouldn't allow her body to be exhumed, he wouldn't allow the people to test it, he wouldn't allow her parents to come to the funeral even. His powerful money shut the whole thing up. Going to come to the light one day. The only thing that will keep you sane in a world like this is, "Shall not the judge of all the earth do right?" And one day at the voice of the Son of God, that's going to be an amazing thing. You know, when Jesus was born, there weren't many people there, maybe about a dozen. And when Jesus taught, not too many people followed him. And when Jesus died, there were not many people there. It was a common thing for people to get crucified. The most disgusting thing is there was nobody there on the resurrection morning, at least not one of the 12 disciples, with all the vows that they had made. And so Jesus numerically, except when he fed the multitude, did not draw great crowds. But you know, this is the finale. There's going to be the mass of people like the stars of heaven for multitude and like the sands by the seashore innumerable. Because everybody is going to rise at the judgment seat of Christ. John says, I saw the dead. He has a preview of eternity. Now listen, when you folk got married, you rehearsed the thing the night before, didn't you? Don't you think it would be pretty reasonable if we as believers tried to rehearse our standing before Christ in that awesome day? We're not going to be judged with that multitude of sinners. I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. People say sometimes, well, if God is just, why is there a hell? Because hell is God's madhouse. The people who are morally insane. It's a place where he's going to shut them off forever and ever. There is no mercy, there is no hope. And we're going to see the dead, small and great, stand before God. Sometimes I look, as I did the other day, a friend of mine has the Encyclopedia Britannica. And I thought, one day those leaves are going to open, and everybody mentioned on those leaves, from the Roman Empire, the British Empire, the Medo-Persian Empire, great men, small men, the kings of the earth, the caliphs of Baghdad, the Maharajas of India, the greatest statesmen. They're going to stand one day. They have to give an account to God for the life he loaned them. Can you imagine us sitting there for a million or 2 years watching God try everybody in the mafia? Well, we're going to see one day. They've liquidated person after person and got away with it. The law's been blind to them very often. After all, Al Capone was supposed to have put to death at least 12 people, but the government got him for income tax. They never touched him for all his barbarity and devilishness. And the massacre they had on, what, St. Valentine's Day, he got away with it. The man in the world says it's an unjust world. If you have money, you can pull strings. Here, prestige, power, money will not do a thing for us. We're going to sit back and we're going to see Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and the Judge of Judges. He is wisdom. He doesn't need it. He is wisdom. And the word says every knee shall bow and every tongue confess. And I anticipate one of the greatest joys in eternity will be to see everybody from Adam, every person who's lost anyhow, stand at the judgment seat of Christ and give an account for the deeds done in the body. I'm reminded of last week that we took a little of this. Maybe this is summed up best in a poem that I think was written here in America. I dreamed that the great judgment morning had come and the trumpet had blown. I dreamed that the nations had gathered for judgment before the white throne. On the bank stood a bright shining angel. He stood on the land and the sea, and he swore with his hand raised to heaven that time was no longer to be. And oh, what a weeping and wailing when the last heard of their fate. They cried for the rocks and the mountains, that scripture. The kings of the earth. Those men that don't know how to spend their money. What is it? The Rockefellers have, what, 250 horns in this country? Billions of dollars? The DuPonts? All the other czars of wealth? The barons who own the bank? The word of God says that when they see him, they're going to cry, rocks and hills, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth upon the throne. So this writer says, oh, what a weeping and wailing when the lost heard of their fate. They cried for the rocks and the mountains, they cried. But their prayer was too late. The rich man was there, but his money had melted and vanished away. A pauper, he stood in the judgment. His debts were too heavy to pay. The gambler was there, and the drunkard, and the man who gave them the drink. And the fellow that gave them the license, and forever in hell they did sink. And oh, what a weeping and wailing. When the lost heard of their fate, mercy is clean gone forever. In heaven they sing the song of Moses and of the Lamb. That will be wonderful. I don't find there's any music in hell. I'd make a guess there's one chorus they sing. And that would be from Jeremiah 8 or 9. The harvest is past. The summer is ended. and we're not saved. The moral man came to the judgment. The body is self-righteous acts would not do. The men that crucified Jesus passed off as moral men too. And so he goes on and he describes all these people who are going to stand there at the judgment seat of Christ. They're going to rise from every battlefield in the world. The caliphs, the maharajas, the kings. Those rich men that don't know what to do with the money down in Saudi Arabia right now. They're going to stand nervously trembling. Man, if you're one of those nice people that doesn't shout hallelujah, I think you might shout that bit. I can't wait to see Hitler bow the knee to Jesus Christ. And right after him, maybe big fat Mussolini. He's going to bow the knee. He's going to explain why he ordered the massacre of people in Ethiopia. I'm going to see Napoleon and Charlemagne. All these amazing characters in history that never for a moment dreamed that when they designed their great mausoleums, whatever you want to call them, that one day, at the voice of the Son of God, even if you build a pyramid higher than Cheops, at the voice of the Son of God, they're going to rise. And they're going to come to judgment. But it's the other side of the coin I'm interested in tonight, the judgment of the believers. We used to sing a hymn often in England, 10,000 times 10,000 in sparkling raiment white. The armies of the ransomed Lord, they go up in streams of white. It's finished, all is finished. Their cry against death and sin. Spring open wide the golden gates and let the victors in. What rush of hallelujahs will ring from earth and sky. What ringing of a thousand harps will speak the triumph night, the day for which creation and all its tribes were made. As one hymn writer says, from earth's wide bounds and ocean's farthest coast, through gates of pearl stream in a countless host, singing to Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, hallelujah. Man that wrote When the Saints Come Marching In didn't write it for that bunch of foolish fellows down in New Orleans to jazz and sway and sing. He was singing of when the redeemed go there. Oh, I think of the unholy dead, God getting down into ancient Babylon and bringing all those voluptuous, extravagant, wicked, perverted people. And then he dips down into France in the reign of the kings, and then he goes to Spain. And then he goes round the world, he comes to Chicago's nightclubs, he goes to London with Soho, with its corruption, he goes over the channel, as it were, and he touches everybody sleeping, who wasted their lives in impurity and devilry. He's going to bring the men that first polluted a girl's body. He's going to bring the men that make millions out of drugs. He's going to bring the brewers. He's going to bring them all there in that day. And there's not one of them can bribe God. There's not one of them has an excuse. Oh, wouldn't it be wonderful to watch Pharaoh stand there while Moses comes up and witnesses against him. I rather like Moses. I don't remember seeing him, but anyhow, I like reading his amazing exploits, and one day I'm going to see that awful, awful man. Yes, sir, and not only see Moses, but I'm going to see Ramesses the First, Ramesses the Second, Ramesses the Third, Charlemagne, the great kings, rulers of empires. They won't have a thing. Everything for which they live has gone into dust. They took nothing out of time into eternity except a guilty conscience and a hideous record of everybody that they slaughtered down the ages. It's all going to come to the surface, and shall not the judge of all the earth do right? He surely will. Be an awesome day. But Paul here is talking about another group of people when he talks about that we shall stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and every man's work is going to be tried by fire. You may remember he says the same thing in Romans 14. He says, why dost thou judge thy brother in verse 10, or why dost thou set at naught thy brother? For we shall stand, all stand. We shall all stand. He's writing to believers. You say there's no condemnation to those of us who are in Christ. Well, you've got to hitch that onto the seventh chapter of Romans. Because our past in the mercy of God has been erased. He plunged it in the sea of his forgetfulness forever. Now, we're not going to judgment to decide whether we go to heaven or not. That's all being settled at the cross. Judgment passed for us at the cross, thank God. Now, I could take a number of nights on this. I'm trying to write a book on it, as a matter of fact. You know, one of the awesome things in the little epistle of Jude, which is an epitome of the whole Bible, know ye not that the angels that rebelled in that rebellion against God with Satan, they're reserved in chains until the great day of judgment. Writing to the Romans, he says, don't you realize that some of the saints are going to judge angels? Won't that be something? I don't know who they are. But someday the saints are going to stand before millions maybe of angels, and angels are going to be judged by mortals like you who have a resurrection body and a glorified mind. Writing to the, let me see, where does he say it? In 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 5. And verse 9 he says, let me go back, verse 8. We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Wherefore we labor, that whether present or absent, we may be accepted of him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that every one of us may receive the things done in his body, according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. Now listen, this is the man that wrote the 1 Corinthians 30, the most sublime poem on love ever written. And I can't go to that without remembering, this is the man who was going down the Damascus Road breathing out threatening. He carried in his toga, that Roman garment, what he thought was the death sentence of the early church. No sooner was Jesus born, Herod said, I liquidate him. No sooner was the church born, and Paul says, I liquidate him. And that man breathing fire. What, do you think I'm going to sit here and see the faith of my fathers destroyed? Do you think I'm going to let a bunch of nondescript people that don't have an intellectual amongst them start destroying the Hebrew faith? Not on your life. I'll exterminate them. I'll put them to death. And that fire-breathing man was so transformed by the power of God. He wrote 1 Corinthians 13, love beareth all things. Oh, isn't that a thing? Isn't that a change? Doesn't that make you remember the word? It's in the Corinthians, and such were some of ye that you washed, some of you girls that have been prostituting maybe now, and your body be reasoned gone to hell. And yet God in infinite mercy came in and he rescued. Paul believed that Jesus so loved the world, that God so loved the world he gave his only begotten son. I think he kind of got over that, but I'll tell you one thing he never got over. Because he wrote, God so loved the world. The Apostle Paul says, Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. Now that's wonderful. The love of God, at least for a season, stretches over all mankind. And then the love of Christ stretches over the church. But he says, you want to know something more wonderful than God loving the world? You want to know something more wonderful than Christ loving the church? He loved me! Now let me ask you a question. Have you made love to Jesus Christ, or do you only make it when you come to church and get sloppy and sentimental and sing when I survey the wondrous Christ? Love is the greatest motivating power in the world. And yet this man who wrote and said he loved me, the man who never forgot the fact that one day God reached hold of a man, not a drunkard. He was even a super edition of Nicodemus. He said he never broke the law. He's a scholar, he's a gentleman. He's everything going for him. He's of the tribe of Benjamin and the seed of Abraham. He's not only a Pharisee, his father was a Pharisee. He says, I'm a Pharisee of a Pharisee. I've got everything going for me. Oh boy, and then you know what he says? Well, he did what we sing and don't do. You know what he did? He said, my richest gain I count but loss and pour contempt on all my fighters. Everybody was reaching for these honors, and he says, they're done. He becomes almost offensive. They're done to me. What are they in the light of eternity? What are they in the light of that love? So amazing and so divine. He loved me. And though he overflows with love, he says in the second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 5 and verse 11, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. If you haven't read it, some of you fellows should read that marvelous sermon of Jonathan Edwards, Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. It seems to me people are trying to tell me now that God is in the hands of angry sinners. They want him to change the Ten Commandments and give us 10 suggestions. They want God to cool it a little while. It's too stiff and difficult. I don't want much TV, but I did see Barbara Walters interviewing Bing Crosby not too long before he died. And he said, you've a wonderful family. Now, supposing one of your teenage boys decided to have a weekend and catch up with a girlfriend, what would he do? He said, show him the door, he'd never come back. You don't mean that in a day like this. You see, you've got to change God and accommodate him to our lousy, dirty living. You mean you shut the door in your boy's face because he slept with his girlfriend before he was married? Definitely, Bing said. We're trying to turn things round. You see, Paul here says, knowing the terror of the Lord, therefore, we persuade men. It's going to be wonderful in eternity to see the Apostle Paul. Let me go back to this text a minute here. At the judgment of sinners, we're going to see the scum of the earth. Oh, we'll see a lot of self-righteous church people. We'll see a lot of people who are goody-goodies. But they rejected Jesus Christ as Savior, and that's the only way that we get into heaven. But at this other judgment, it's so different. This is not the judgment of the unholy dead. When you look at people and you want to shrink and say, God, the smell from them almost kills me. No, that's true. I'm convinced one of the great bonuses of eternity will be that we shall stand or sit before the judgment seat and watch God judge people of all the ages. If it takes 100 million years, so what? You're going nowhere? Time is over, eternity has begun. God can take 10 million years judging Hitler, so what? It will not be exciting. And all the characters in history. But Paul here is writing to believers, and he says, we're laborers together with God, we are God's husbandry. Look, let's forget about all the sewers that God's going to pull the cork out of and pour them all in some vast auditorium or somewhere and show us every sinner, every pervert, every liar, every drunkard, every rotten person. Forget it for a minute. Let's look at the other side of the story and look at all the holy dead. Won't they be wonderful? I love reading missionary biographies. They always embarrass me and humiliate me, but I like to read. I like to think there'll be a bunch up there, and I say, hey, brother, look there. See all those wonderful men there? There's Gilmore of Mongolia, and there's Judson of Burma, and there's the little man about this height who split Africa open, David Livingstone. And who's that fellow over there? But I'm going to see them all. C.G. Studd, you name them. They're all coming to the judgment seat, and every man shall receive his own reward. I think it would be interesting to see all the Johns. John Wesley, John Knox, John Huss. See a fellow there, who's that? Oh, that's John Calvin, he made it finally, right. we're going to see them all one day at the judgment seat of Christ. Won't that be wonderful? Huh? 10,000 times 10,000 is 100 million in garments white. 10,000 times 10,000 in sparkling raiment white, the armies of the ransomed God, they walk up the streets of light. It's finished, all is finished. You can't pray anymore, you can't win souls anymore, you can't sacrifice anymore. It's all over. This is a finale. Man, I'm going to keep my eyes open and look for these wonderful people up here, you know, Jeremiah and Isaiah and these Ezekiel, these something. And these little fellows that they call ignorant, I'm sure, there's Daniel, and then there's Hosea and Amos and Habakkuk, that's some name, and Zechariah and Malachi. They're all going to be there at the judgment seat. And then we're going to see Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Acts. Well, everybody in Acts. And we're going to see all the people in the Roman church, and the epistle to the Philippians, and the epistle to the Ephesians. You know, Epaphroditus. That man in the book of Revelation, I thought of about 2 o'clock this morning, and I don't know a thing about him, neither do you, so I'm on good ground here. Because the word of God, the book of the Revelation says what? Antipas, my faithful martyr. Nobody knows a thing about Antipas except he was martyred. The devil's crucifix is said to be a crucifix upside down. So they put Peter and crucified him upside down. They once crucified 5,000 people down the Appian Way. How wonderful to see the 12 apostles. Oh, Mary and Martha. I'm going to have a word about Mary. She's blessed my life so many times. You know, she's spilled that ointment on the feet of Jesus. It'll be fragrant in eternity. And we're going to see all the heroes of faith. The people who were massacred in the St. Bartholomew Massacre or St. Valentine's there, some of the... Oh, all those people that were butchered for Christ's sake. I remember being on an island in the South Seas, and they said the first missionary to this country was martyred right there by that rock. They chopped his head off. They put him to death for bringing the gospel. Yeah, it sounds facetious, but won't it be wonderful to see John Wesley face to face? Huh? And John Knox, and even Calvin, all right, let's bring him in. Hmm? And John Huss, and William Booth, founder of the Salvation Army. And those men who were the womb in which God conceived revival away there through the Presbyterian Church, 1904-5 in Korea. The Christians who were slaughtered in the Boxer Rising. You can't find out where they're buried, but you know what? God's got every marker. He's got every name. He knows the geographical section where they're buried. And at the voice of the Son of God, they're going to rise. Now, that's beautiful, but listen to what Paul says. If any man build on this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest. That's the 13th verse of 1 Corinthians 3. For the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work. Notice that it's fire trying every man's work, not what size it is, what sort it is. Now, come on, sweet little lady, you won't have your darling husband to lean on. You're going to stand there before 1,000,000,000 eyes and give an account to God. And he's going to take the whole of your life of service and put it in a crucible. See, we say a lot about God is love. I see it stuck on bumpers of all the movies, God is love. I never see a sticker that says, our God is a consuming fire, but he is. I'm convinced in my spirit the reason the world goes to hellfire tonight is because the church has lost Holy Ghost fire. There's no way out of the world. The sinner goes to hellfire. The believer goes to judgment fire. And we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. And the fire shall try every man's work. Oh, this was very real to the people here at Corinth. You know why? Because they had class distinctions like we have. Because there were people built, lived in lovely homes that were made of granite and marble. And across the tracks, people lived in houses made of wood and wattle. That is, they mixed clay and they mixed straw. And the rich got richer in those days and the poor got poorer. And there was a great gulf between the two. They didn't mix. But not too long before the apostle wrote this to the Corinthians, the city caught fire. It had the biggest fire it ever had. And when the fire was over, the houses made of wood and hay and stubble were just so deep in ashes. But the houses that were made of beautiful marble and beautiful chiseled granite were still standing. And Paul says that's a picture of the day when God takes all the works of your life and he puts the fire of his judgment on it. Now, if you're built on a good foundation, silver, gold, and precious stones, you'll be all right. But if your life has been showmanship, you've just done things to get some nice commendation from people, well, the fire will try every man's work. Again, not what size it is, what sort it is. Now, let's put it this way. Supposing we give 6 people $10,000. And I say to this man, look, you go buy $10,000 worth of wood, and you buy hay, and you buy stubble. And you go buy $10,000 worth of gold, and you buy $10,000 worth of silver, and you buy $10,000 worth of precious stone. And they come back with what they've purchased, and here is a man, he's bought $10,000 worth of wood. Well, if it's good mahogany, he wouldn't get too much wood for that. And I put the fire to it. What happens? It just filters down, and maybe there's enough ash to come up to my knees. But that $10,000 he invested, which is typical of his life's work, will not stand the fire. He invested in wood. Wood, hay, stubble are above the ground. Silver, gold, and precious stones are beneath the ground. There's an awful lot of service done for God that's above the ground. It catches the eye. And you feel good when you've done it. And somebody sends you a letter of thanks or something. Well, that's all right. Listen, get this in your little head. If you do anything for God, he won't reward you twice. We say to people sometimes, if God has forgiven your sins, he won't demand it of you. He doesn't demand payment twice. Then he doesn't give rewards twice. If you receive your reward of men, you'll get no reward up there. Jesus based everything on reward. He said the Pharisees like to stand at the street corner. They stroked their beards. They held their hands together. They said long prayers. Why? Right. They received their reward, Jesus says, because they received the praise of men. That's what they wanted. All right. Your investment of wood, it's burned up. Your investment of hay is bigger, and you set fire, and it comes down, and instead of ashes to your knees, you've got ashes here up to your chest. And then you set fire to $10,000 worth of stubble, and you've so much ash you can't even walk through it, but it doesn't alter the fact. None of them was able to abide the test of the fire. Now this man has bought $10,000 worth of gold. I have a little crucible here, an induction crucible. I put his bar of gold in, I press certain buttons, and the heat begins to multiply. And what happens to the gold? The only thing that happens is the gold changes from a solid block to liquid. But its quality is not changed. You haven't burned anything out of it. You ever sing a hymn, a chorus that says this? Let the beauty of Jesus be seen in me. All his wonderful passion and purity, all thou spirit divine, all my nature refined, until the beauty of Jesus is seen in me. When a man is purifying gold, he stands over it with a ladle and he takes the scum off the top and throws it out and takes it off and throws it out and takes it off and throws it out. And one day he looked, one time he looks and he walks back. And you say, well, why don't you skim it again? He says, because there's no impurity. How do you know? Because when gold is pure, it acts like a mirror. And when I look into that crucible, I can see the perfect image of myself. So he refines and he purifies us until he sees his image in us. This is the whole work of redemption. We're to be transformed into the image of his son. But you see, gold there is a type of devotion. You know, people say sometimes, well, in the previous study there, of course, in Revelation 20, it says the books are open. Well, I'm glad there are no books open for the Christian, I assure. You better go back to Malachi. It says in the 3rd chapter, there is a book of remembrance written. Now, gold is typical of our devotional life. I think when I was here before, I spoke on worship. One of the most neglected things to get in the presence of God and gaze on his holiness and majesty with speechless adoration. Prayer is preoccupation with my needs. Praise is preoccupation with my blessings. Worship is preoccupation with God himself. One hymn writer says, my goal is God himself. Not joy, not peace, not even blessing, but be my God. Tell me, when did you last bask in the presence of the eternal God? Not ask him a thing. Not pray. Not praise. Just gaze on his holiness, on his mercy, on his majesty. One day before assembled millions, he's going to take my devotional life and he's going to put it in a crucible and he's going to tie it by fire. Silver. What is silver? I was reading only today in the book of Psalms. It says in the 12th Psalm, verse 3, the Lord shall cut off all flattering lips and the tongue that speaketh proud things. Who have said, with our tongue we will prevail. Our lips are our own, who's Lord over us? For the oppression of the poor, for the sighing of the needy. Now will I rise, saith the Lord. I will set him on high. I will set him in safety from him that puffeth him. And the words of the Lord are pure words, as silver is tried in a furnace. Did you ever sit down and contemplate that from the first day you were saved and you became the property of Jesus Christ, he's been running, as it were, a tape on your conversation, and every word you said, good or bad, slanderous, worshipful, critical, he's going to play it all back one day. Because the Word of God says that man shall give an account for every idle word that he has spoken. We're so prodigal with our words. I guess if I'm speaking at a good rate, I speak about 150 words a minute. Well, then in 10 minutes, I speak about 1,500 words. And 6 times that in an hour is 6,000, and 6 times is, 9,000 words an hour? We're told the average lawyer uses 20,000 words a day. And all those words are accumulated. The good words, the bad words, the critical words. John Wesley said in his day that the greatest tragedy of the church in that day was that there was so much criticism. Unjust criticism. Critical speech. The Lord says, with thy mouth thou art justified, and with thy words thou shalt be condemned. Years ago we were going through Birmingham, Alabama. Stopped to see a friend of mine and he said, well, Brother Raven, good to see you. And he said, sit in the chair here. And I said, no. He said, I got it yesterday. It was a preacher's chair, a lazy boy. And he said, sit in my chair. And I said, no, you sit in the chair. He said, I'll tell you something if you sit in the chair. Last night my wife said that so-and-so and so-and-so were coming to spend the evening with us. And I said, oh, not her. She's the biggest gossip we have in the church. So he said, I thought, okay. And he said, I pinned a microphone on the back of the chair. And I ran my tape around here, my tape recorder, and I listened and I put down every word she said. And oh, she really got going. She criticized the church and the pastor and this and that and the other, and she knew what was wrong with everybody except herself anyhow. And she had a great time. Then she said to her husband, you know, it's time we were going to go across the city. And he said, well, my friend said, look, you'll take coffee before you go to bed. Why not stay here and have a donut and coffee? And she said, well, I don't know. He said, listen, now, you are a bit of a gossip, aren't you? And she said, well, people do say that. He said, I've got the latest gossip on the church, and if you'd like to stay here and have a cup of coffee, I'll pay it to you. He said to him, right. So he said, as I slipped out, I just turned like this, and I pressed the button, and I went in the kitchen, and she was like, listen, I didn't say that. Now, listen, you give him $10 for this. Give him $20. Get it. We've got to have it. And I walked in with a coffee and just said, do you take sugar and cream? And he said, this tape you're saying, this is what I've been saying for the last hour, isn't it? And finally he said, yes. He said, well, we want the tape. He said, we can't have it. I give you $10, you can't have it. I give you $20, you can't have it. And I don't want coffee or anything. I'm going home. And I'll never come in this house again. That was a mean trick you did. Well, he said, if you're so upset, I'll give you the thing. Oh, really? Give me the thing? Yeah, I'll give you the thing. And he put it in a box. And as she was going out of the door, he said, you don't have another copy of it, do you? And he said, no. He said, well, I'm glad there's not another copy. I didn't say there wasn't. Yes, I did. Just now you said there was. No. You asked me if I had a copy. Well, who else has a copy? Well, while I was recording in here, they were recording up there in heaven, and you've got to give account for every word. You know, she nearly died on the spot. We're so flippant with our words. We're so quick with our judgments. We're so easy with our criticism. We stab and we injure and we hurt. And yet all my words are going to be brought one day to the crucible, and God is going to try my works before 1,000,000,000 people. And then there are precious stones. What are you going to do with the precious stones? Well, the priest in the Old Testament, he wore a breastplate, a little larger than this. It was divided into 12. It had 12 precious stones on it. And there was a different tribe's name on every stone. And he went into the holy place of all, and he bore the nation before God in prayer. You say there's going to be no books in heaven. Oh yes, there are going to be books in heaven. You know, we all try to put on a face and appear we're more spiritual than we are. Don't you think so most times? And this is a great final judgment. This is the exposure. We're going to get our ratings in eternity. We're all going to be the same in heaven. Forget it. We're going to be graded. We're going to have different offices, different positions. A book of remembrance on prayer. Hey, Gabriel, bring the book of prayer for... Let me see. When? When was John Wesley saved? 24th of August, 1738. Bring me the book of prayer for about 1650. And he brings this big volume, and I say, here are all the saints. We're the agape for, in case you didn't know. We're the super saints. And you're going to judge us before very long? And there are all the Methodists, and there are the circuit riders, and there are men like, what was that fellow, Blackwood? No. What was the famous Blackwood preacher? I forgot his name for the moment. What a tremendous character he was. Son? No, Beddington was one, surely. But before that, there was another tremendous man. He knew God so well, but he went to a cabin, family, he went to a logging camp one day. And when he got there, the men had moved on. You see, they had no telephones or communication. Peter Cartwright. When Peter Cartwright got to the logging camp, everybody quit. But there was a big old place they used for a dining hall and they used to preach in. He didn't know a man was walking through the bush and seeing him. And Peter went in and he lit the lamp. And he opened his hymn book and he said, friends, let us sing him the song. There wasn't a soul in the place. The man said, I always thought he was crazy, I'm dead sure now. And then he said, let us pray, and he prayed his heart out. And then he prayed a tremendously anointed word. I'm showing again, you see, sometimes you have to do the thing which is contrary to reason and the flesh and everybody else's advice. And Peter Cartwright stood there and preached his heart out with anointing about being born again. There wasn't a soul there. When it finished, he blew out the lamp and he took his fold that he had his roll from his horse and he laid on the floor and he went to sleep. He was crossing Brooklyn Bridge a few years after. He was a big ungainly man. As he's walking over, a man said, excuse me, sir, aren't you Peter Cartwright? He said, yes, I am. He said, I was saved through you. What, you were? You remember such and such logging camp? Oh, yes, we had some wonderful conversions. Yeah, we used to get 5 or 6 people a night. No, he said. You went there one night. We had moved up the valley and I discovered I'd left my special axe there. You know, they didn't leave them on the floor. They stuck them in a tree. And he said, I said, okay, when it's sundown, I'll go. And he said, as I came to get my axe, you went in that building and you lit a lamp and I squinted through one of the cracks. And he said, you said, everybody, we're going to sing and worship God. And you sang a hymn. And then you prayed and then you sang again. And then you poured your heart out on being born again. He said, I couldn't stay long enough to talk with you, but I walked home through the forest, and before I got to the logging camp, I knelt down, and I was marvelously born again of the Spirit of God. Oh, we want a lot of show and pomp and TV programs and money to get it done. But you see, all those things that are known just to God are going to be rewarded in that day. All right, Gabriel bring the book of prayer. Gabriel comes and spreads the book. Reverently. I think he has a very wonderful voice. And he just pours out a record of that year. And one of the men he talks about is a man by the name of, let's see, he died at the ripe old age of 28, David Brainard. And he reads the page where Brainard says, I got up this morning and the Indians were immoral. They were practicing sexual immorality and they were drunk and swearing and fighting. There was nobody where to pray. So he said, I went out in the forest and I knelt down and the snow was up to my chin. And I wrestled for those Indians from sunrise until sunset. This is a man with a massive body. He weighed about 90 pounds. This is a man who, when he sneezes, sprays the ground with his blood. When he coughs, you'd think he had a flower in his throat. And you pick that petal up from that flower and stretch it. It'll stretch a yard because it's part of his lungs. But you see, one day he fell in love with Jesus and he says, does it matter where I live or how I live, if men perish? Let me live with eternity's values in those. Don't get me trapped in materialism. Don't let me envy the other man, the other preacher. Give me the secret place of the Most High, and there I pour out my soul to God. Do I need anybody else's ears? We were in a certain town in Texas not too long ago. I talked about prayer, and a lady came to me. She said, Mr. Raven, I wish you could come about 80 miles down the road here. We have two old ladies in Texas. They're around about, nearly 80 years of age. And you know those darlings spend 6 to 7 hours a day in prayer? In Texas today. Where are we? March. February was last month. 9th of February, 3 years ago. A friend of mine was carried through the doorway of his little house. And when they carried his little body through that doorway, it was the first time he'd been through that doorway in 12 and a half years. He had never been out to buy a suit or a shirt or anything. He lived and wore what people sent. The size didn't matter. He hadn't been to bed one night for 30 years. Praying by himself. 10 o'clock at night, you'd see him slip up into that little closet that he had. Right through the night till 5 or 6. Whenever the burden lifted. I walked in to see him one day. He was, I think, nearly 80 years of age then. He had a complexion any of you girls would have been jealous of. He had flawless skin, pink cheeks, bright blue eyes, vivacious. God married him to burden. God married him to grief. God married him to passion. God married him to a burden. I'd like to have written his story, sure. I would have put some polish on that, but he wouldn't let me do it. One of my great joys, I guess, partly through my books, is this. That I get people writing to me who tell me, Brother Rainier, I wish you could come down here. There's an old saint here nobody knows anything about, and he's been praying 2 hours a day for the last 15 years or the last 20 years. You know, if the saints are the salt of the earth, praying people are the salt of the church. And if you want an expanse in your soul, then learn to pray. How do you learn to pray? How do you learn to swim? You sit in a chair with your feet up, drinking Coke, and learn to swim? You get down and you struggle. How do you learn to pray? That's how you learn to pray. You see, we'd all like to be saints if you could skip base one, base two, get to the third base and come on for the home run kind of thing, huh? Jowett said years ago, Jowett of Carvering Chapel, Birmingham, made this statement, which I think is beautiful. He said, listen, the secret of Christian life is this, you have to bleed to bless. An experience of God that costs nothing is worth nothing, and it does nothing. So Paul here is giving us a warning. I struggled for years, honest to goodness, I struggled for years with a scripture that says, God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. But the same book of Revelation says there are no tears. Well, there are no tears in heaven. I figured that out this way, that the tears are going to be at the judgment seat of Christ. As Dr. Tozer said, he said, Len, look, I want to tell you something. Number one, not many of us, if any of us, will look God straight in the eye and say like his son, I finished the work thou gavest me to do. We've tripped over too many things. We've been diverted. We started spiritual. We ended in the flesh. We were spiritual. We became soulish. Get this in your mind, you young people particularly. Look, the devil isn't going to try and get you to commit adultery, get drunk, steal, do all of the other things. In your life as a child of God, the good is the enemy of the best. And if he can get you tied up with good things, he'll be as happy as if he got you drunk. For the simple reason you've missed God's supreme will for your life. You say, well, I don't have to have a girlfriend. I don't know. That's between you and God. I don't know. I can't give you do's and don'ts. That's not the thing. But we're talking here about living with eternity's values in view. In World War II, I did a padre's hour, chaplain's hour, in one of the largest Air Force camps in England. And as I went up the hill, up the mountainside, over there in the fields, there was an enormous mansion. It was all bigger than this place. It had its private race course outside. It was where C.T. Studd was raised. You remember the day when he had an encounter with God? He was the Babe Ruth of English cricket. And he had an encounter with God, and he gave his money away. When money was money. He gave about $30,000 to B.L. Moody to help start Moody Bible Institute. He gave another $50,000 or something to William Bould, who was struggling with the Salvation Army. And he set out dead flat with nothing, because he said, I can trust God anyhow. You know, when that man, he went up the Nile and did a job, he went, a little book, if you see, the Cambridge Seven. Seven brilliant young men went from Cambridge University to China and did a missionary job. He'd already done a job in Africa. Then he did a job with the China Inland Mission. And then when he came home, he was beaten, had malaria and whatnot. 53 years of age. And nobody wanted him. He was washed up. He said, I made a statement some years ago, if Jesus Christ be God and died for me, no sacrifice that I could make can be too great for me to make for him. I'm only 53. I'm 3 score years and 10. And at 53 years of age, broken in health, criticized again mercilessly by Christians who should be ashamed of themselves. He went to Central Africa and started the Heart of Africa Mission, which today is Worldwide Evangelization Crusade, which today has about 1,500 missionaries. What's the cause? Scripture says, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die. This is the crux of the whole matter. If you like, you can go back into Romans and you can say with Paul, I have a sinful self that has to be crucified. I have a human self that has to be controlled by the Spirit. I have a true self which can be released in Christ. And I can make my vow to God and by His grace keep on course. He talks about the great people, John Huss and John Knox and John Calvin and all the great saints in heaven. But won't it be interesting to see the dying thief who got there with the last beat of his heart? John Wesley was converted at 35. Turn 35 round, it makes 53. 53 and 35 make 88 when he died. Do you think the dying thief is going to have the same reward as John Wesley, who for 35 years, or 53 years, poured his life out for God? Salvation is free. Rewards are not free. I could spend a night on all the crowns that there are for believers. There's going to be a crown of righteousness. There's going to be a crown for the martyrs. There's a crown, the apostle says, which God the righteous judge shall give me in that day. And not only me, but all them that love His appearing. But there are going to be different crowns. Everybody won't have the same crown. Some are going to rule over one city, some over two cities, some over five cities. Who are they? I don't know. I don't care. But let me show you the investment of a life. As I said this morning, if you want to think of it this way, the royal family in England is like this. Well, they're the top of the pile. This is the worst ordinary people. Here is John Wesley's family, the highest family next to the royal family. Now, in my book, John Wesley was a genius. From being 35 years of age. But in fact, let me go back. Do you know my problem with John Wesley? He was more spiritual when he wasn't spiritual than I am when I am spiritual. You know, before he was saved, he fasted all day Wednesday and all day Friday. He got as far as that. Oh, we live easy. We live fluffy. We're not in bondage to anybody. Well, if you're not, you're not a true disciple. Because all Jesus wants is love slaves. He doesn't want bosses. He doesn't want managers. He wants those who work together with him. All right, John Wesley is converted at 35 years of age. For 53 years, he lived a disciplined life. Went to bed at the right time, got up at the right time, did everything at the right time. He died at 88 years of age. When he died, just before he died, the IRS came after him. He didn't think they did it in those days. They asked him, "What are you doing with six silver spoons?" Well, you see, when he died, all he left was six silver spoons. A faded Geneva gown he used to preach in. A handful of books. £6 notes worth $5 each. He said, "Get six poor men. Don't give me an ostentatious funeral. Oh, they've got a disc on the wall of Westminster Abbey now. They didn't bury him like that." The last 600 sermons that Mr. Wesley preached, he preached six of them in a sanctuary. He preached the other 594 in the street. Nobody would give him a pulpit. He used his dad's tombstone as a pulpit. So what did he leave when he died? £6 notes, six silver spoons, a handful of books, a faded Geneva gown. Something else, what was that? Oh, I know, the Methodist Church. I knew there was something. He didn't waste a penny. He didn't waste a moment of time. In the moonlight, on horseback, he'd be reading a primer, a Greek primer or a Latin primer, getting his eyes down and quoting it going down the road in the moonlight. As the hymn writer says, give every flying minute something to keep in store. You say this is bondage. It's blessed bondage, I'll tell you that. The angels aren't waiting till you just get inside the pearly gate to give you a six-decker crown and jewels and a free ticket to the marriage supper of the Lamb and the title deeds to a mansion on Main Street and a few other gorgeous things the evangelist lied to you about. There's nothing gratis in eternity. We have to earn everything that we're going to be rewarded for. not in three. Well, the time's gone. You know, there's another minister I think is very wonderful. I've heard people say, now you've got money, now look, I wish you'd give us $10,000 for this thing we're going to do, you know. The Lord will reward you. Now you don't listen to them folk at all, I wouldn't. Or let's put it this way. Here's a man, wealthy, so he has to be a Texan. And they bury him in a gold coffin because he's a Texan. And the pastor says, friends, I want to tell you something. You know, we have wanted money so long. And Brother Jack Jones here departed the life last night. We're burying him this afternoon in the most beautiful coffin you've ever had. And I want to tell you this. He has left $10 million for our church and our mission society. And Jones says, wonderful. And somebody says, won't he get a reward when he gets to eternity? Well, I'll tell you, in my book, he won't get 10 cents for it. Why not? Well, come and look at him before I put the lid down. Here he is, laid out in style. Good looking man. He's torn his checkbook up. He doesn't need it where he's going. So he's left us $10 million. And just before I put the lid down, I want to remind you of the scripture. You say he's given it to the Lord and he'll get a reward, all right. But it happens to say in this old English Bible I have, the Lord loveth what? It doesn't look very cheerful to me, I mean. And secondly, he didn't give it. He'd still have it if he was alive today. Death took it with a pistol point and said, give it up. Now this isn't from Shakespeare, it's from an American who said, well, this is what you should do then. If you've got money, do your giving while you're living, then you're knowing where it's going. See, it's not. It's not very classy poetry, but it's rather sense in it. We're all going to appear at the judgment seat. Now I know you're a strong Christian, you're very faithful, and you feel so happy. Let me ask you just a couple of things. John Wesley lived 53 years of disciplined, holy life. Sure, he made money. Do you know what he did with it? Printed hymn books, printed Bibles, raised orphanages, raised churches. Didn't keep anything. David Brainerd. Ooh, America is such a rotten country that we've hatched every abomination in this country. Tell me what we didn't hatch. Jehovah's Witnesses, Mormonism, go on, they were all born in this country. They cursed the world. Before you throw your hymn book at me, let me tell you something. Some of the greatest men that ever prayed were born in this country. And through with this, I was in a conference, a lady came to me and she said, Brother Ravenhill, did you ever meet Praying Hyde? I said, no. No, I didn't meet Praying Hyde. Did you meet him? She said, yes, at the 5 o'clock convention in India. What was he like? Oh, a marvelous man. She said, you know, sometimes we ask men like you, will you come and preach for us? We ask another, will you come and teach Bible? We ask somebody else, will they come and sing? But all we did with John Hyde, we used to say, Brother Hyde, you'll be back next year, won't you, to pray? And she said, he prayed in the back room. And she said, one of my friends said to him one day, Brother Hyde, I'd like to pray with you. Could I pray with you? And he said, yes. Yeah, come in the morning about 9:30. And he said, I got there early and I slipped in that room and I knelt down to pray and John Hyde came in and we were quiet for 15 minutes. That kills most of us. So I thought I'd better pray. So he said, I'd prayed. Oh, I prayed. The longest I'd ever prayed in my life, about 15 minutes, but I was dried up. I didn't know what else to pray about, so I quit. He said, I looked at my watch when John Hyde began to pray. It was 10 o'clock. 10 o'clock. I never heard a man pray like that. Do you know what the most eloquent prayer is? When you don't say a word. Hannah never said a word. She got a prayer answered. And she, he prayed, he went in, up into the heavenlies, and then he stopped. And we had just got going in that prayer meeting when somebody knocked at the door. And he said, my friend said, well, I'm not going to the door because I don't want to break this prayer meeting up. And I hope the folk go away anyhow, but they knocked again, and they knocked a third time. And I didn't go to the door, and John Hyde didn't go to the door. And then somebody put their head round the door and said, Brother Hyde, we ought to give a Bible reading on prayer at 3 o'clock, and it is 3:45. This lady said, her friend said, well, that's about the crazy thing I've ever heard. You haven't been praying 15 minutes, 3:45. We started praying at 10:15. 10:45 is 1 hour. 12:15, 12:15, 12:15, 12:15. What, we've been praying 5 hours? It's ridiculous. Until I looked at my watch and saw that we had prayed 5 hours. One of the greatest men the world has ever had was John Hatch. One of the greatest men the world ever had was praying patient of Portland, the man who had a floor in his bedroom like this, and he wore grooves in the floor with his knees because he used to pray with energy like this. And when they buried him, they found he had hooves on his knees. And they found that there were ruts in the ground where, with his intercession, he had worn the floorboards away. Well, of course, I could keep you going for a long while telling about the great men of this country of prayer. What thrills me more is that I know that a great, wonderful... I'm not too thrilled with great preachers as such. I was in a conference, a great national conference of somebody. And somebody said, could we pray, Brother Raven? And I said, yes, let's pray. Let's have a prayer meeting. We didn't go out of the auditorium. We got behind the platform and we prayed. And one man whose books you've read on prayer, a very famous man, squeezed up to me and put his hand on my shoulder. He said, Len, would you lay hands on me that the spirit of prayer would come? I don't pray. He's in big demand as a speaker. He can talk eloquently about prayer. But you see, prayer is the simplest form of speech that infant lips can try. And prayer is so vast that it exhausts our vocabulary. And then as the epistle says there in Jude says, we really start praying then in the Holy Ghost. When I do not pray what I want, I don't give God a shopping list. He begins to breathe through me. After all, if you have a friend, you can laugh with anybody, you can't weep with anybody, you can't have anybody share your secrets. And even Jesus says, my yoke is easy, my burden. Give me 2 minutes, somebody waves there, the things off anyhow. I was in a conference one day with Raymond Edmond, the great educator of, where was he? Outside of Chicago there. What's the school? Thank you, Wheaton. And Dr. R.R. Brown said, tell Brother Raven about your experience. All right, so he went down there to Uruguay, I think. He'd learned the language, he was all ready to go, and everything was going well, and he took ill, and he was dying. And down there, you have to bury a person the same day, and so his wife ordered the grave to be dug. She only had one dress, a white one, apart from the one she was wearing. So she took a wedding dress and she took some berries and plunged the dress into the berries and hung it up to dry. Went back and she started mopping his brow. He had a death rattle in his throat. It was terrible. And her mind was spinning. Why does this man with education and degrees come here and going to do a missionary job and the world falls apart? He's going to die and I'm going to be like, what's the sense in it? And she said his death rattle got louder. He made a horrible noise. He put a hand out like that to wipe the sweat off his brow. And he sat up straight and said, bring me my clothes. Then she nearly died. Bring your clothes. I feel great. You know, he got up. I heard him say this more than once. I got up from that bed of death and never looked back. He was at a conference up in Boston. Somebody said, tell us about your miraculous healing. And this is not just a fairy story. A little old lady did come up to him and say, well, Dr. Edmund, do you have a record? Do you know the day? Well, usually if you're raised from the dead, you'd know, I think. And he said, yes, it was so-and-so. What time was it? So-and-so. What time would it be in Boston? Oh, it would be sometime in the morning. And he said with a trembling finger, you see this? And he read it. 2 a.m. in the morning, God said, get up. The devil's trying to kill Raymond Edmund. Now, why in the world does Almighty God need the help of a woman 70 years of age to get him delivered? I don't know. And she says, I prayed. And then underneath, she'd written a little hallelujah, he's better. And she said, I got back into bed. You ever hear God's voice telling you to pray? I do. Sometimes I have to pray for India or China or something. I never see those people. That doesn't worry me at all. I do as God tells me. I go to bed 10:30 at night usually, and I sleep right through till 11:30. And then I get up. I go prayer. I go work. Rest of it during the day. Why not? Doesn't matter what union you're in. It doesn't say if you go to bed at 10 and get up at 6, does it? You see, we live, even as God's people, we live very much on our five senses and our sixth sense, which is nonsense. We're spiritual beings. God is a spirit. I am a spiritual being. I respond to God who is a spirit. The only contact I have with God is through my spirit. And you know what? If you listen, he'll talk to you. You don't have to keep a diary and tell everybody how many wonderful answers to prayer you have. I'd rather God whisper to me and tell me to pray than somebody call me and say, I don't play golf anyhow, but supposing I did, and say, hey, come on, we're going to have a foursome or have something else, come and play golf, or come and do this, come and do that. That wouldn't interest me at all. You see, life, what is life? Well, here you are. This is what life is. Life is an island of time surrounded by an ocean of eternity. And you get off one way, but whichever way you get off, you're going into eternity. And if you start to gear your life, as one hymn writer says, live with eternity's values in view. You'll change your prayer life. You'll change the way you use your time. You'll change the way you use your money. You'll change the way you use your conversation. You'll change the way you use your everything, because you suddenly become eternity conscious. I have a sign in my office, eternity. Somebody gave me a nice flat watch, a nice steel one. It's very nice. And I made up my mind when I go out west, I'm going out to Arizona, Scottsdale, and some friends of ours, they have a shop. They engrave things. I'm going to have eternity put on the back of my watch. So Walter Scott had engraved on the back of his watch, the night cometh when no man can work. Don't fool yourself, all Christians die happy. Christians die miserable. Lord, if you'd let me live a bit longer, I'd use my time better, I'd use my money better, forget it. I've been trying to get that through to you for 10 years. And you can squeal and howl and he won't lengthen your life necessarily. Isn't it great that while other people invest their life in stupid things, Hollywood career, some other junk, that you and I can get in line with God's will and pray and hear his voice and sacrifice some for him and surrender our choices and say, take my will and make it thine, it shall be no longer mine. Or say like the old Scot, make me a captive, Lord, and then I shall be free. Force me to render up my sword, and I shall conquer thee. I sink in life's alarms, when by myself I stand. Imprison me within thine arms, and strong shall be my band. You can't show me a man that God has used in history who has not been a disciplined man. You can't show me a man who somewhere in his career didn't suddenly get off the 3-foot end and dive into the deep 15 feet, if you like, of prayer. said in a meeting the other day, and I might do with this, because he gave me passionate strength, some of you were there in Atlanta. And I said, you know, one thing that I do want to be known, I'm not ambitious to be known as a good preacher, but I want my name in big red letters, 10 feet high. Where? In hell. If I'm not known in hell, I'm not much good. Why? Because the demons said one day, when some fellows tried to get them out of the man, they said, Jesus we know. That's great, isn't it? Every demon in hell knew the name of Jesus. But listen, they said, Paul we know. And they said to the preachers who were trying to get the demons out of someone else, but who are you? Never heard of you. You know, at the judgment seat of Christ, I believe that God will bring the devil to stand there and witness against us. And you'll see how many times he cheated us, how many times he deceived us. On the other hand, how many times we were more than conquerors through him that loved us. How we denied ourselves, took up our cross, followed him. Gave every flying minute something to keep in store. In other words, we got orientated. We got the wavelength of eternity, and after that, the things of earth grow strangely dim. Won't it be wonderful to stand and look at our blessed Lord in his face there and say, Lord, as best I knew how, I did your will. You'll say, all right, bring out the record. John Wesley will be leaning over there listening and looking and saying, I wondered what those Christians did in 1978. Boy, they were a flabby lot. They did more singing than sighing, and they did more feasting than fasting, and they did more other things than sweating and praying in the Holy Ghost. See, John Wesley was a genius. He had about a dozen men with him, and they were not geniuses, but I'll tell you what, in my book, they were as spiritual as he was. They knew how to wrestle against principalities and powers. They were as tall spiritually, not socially, not intellectually, but spiritually they were his equals, and they banded together. Lecky, a secular historian, says when the bloody revolution swept over France, they swept the monarchy into the garbage can. They took a hog and cut its throat and put it on the altar of Notre Dame Cathedral. Another day they took a famous harlot and stripped her and stuck her on the cathedral altar just to spoil it, whatever you want to say. Desecrating. And when they got rid of the monarchy and got rid of everybody else, every institution crushed it to death, they put up their tricolour, red, white and blue, liberty, fraternity and equality. And Lecky is a secular historian, and he says this, that when that mighty river of impurity was going to sweep over England, God raised up a man. Well, God's looking for men today. We're in such a mess, governments can't help us, money can't help us, the bankers can't help us, education can't help us. Either God splits the heavens and comes down and gives us one great breathing outpouring of his spirit, what I call a Pentecost, Pentecost. Oh, we're finished. But the reason I like to talk to folk like you is this again, because I've got the answer. It's in Joel chapter 2 where it says, your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Not the grey heads and the wise men and the rich men. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men see visions. Your old men dream dreams. And on my servants and handmaids I'll pour out of my spirit. I believe there's going to be such a gully washer, as the old saint used to say. There's going to be such a rending of the heavens and a manifestation of God's glory and power right before a real tribulation breaks in. It will be the greatest manifestation of God the world has ever seen. Jesus will see of the travail of his soul and be satisfied.